Don't knock on wood ever again. I know that sounds crazy, but trust me, it's not worth it. It's not worth it because you might not be ready of what you're invited into your life. I definitely wasn't. About a month ago, I packed up what few possessions I owned and tossed them into the back of my Toyota Camry. I left my dumpy apartment in Utica, New York, and headed for a small town called Mora, 3 hours upstate. I'd never heard of this place before, but I settled on it. It was the only spot I could afford and maybe save a decent amount of money at the same time. I probably should have done a bit more research on Mora. There is simply not much there besides a gas station, several old churches, and one rundown bar. The nearest grocery store is 30 minutes away, the nearest police station 40. The interstate highway is an hour. You get the picture. Middle of nowhere. But luckily, the bar had an opening, and as I attended bar after college for a time, I landed a job there pretty quickly. The work gave me a lifeline while I hunted for something in my profession, teaching history at the high school level. The bar was called The Deep and sat on the outskirts of town not far from lonely block roads. The place had a permanent mask about it. You could have walked in there in the 90s, and I swear you wouldn't have been able to tell the difference from today. It was at the end of my first week working at the bar when it happened. The owner was a guy named Darren. He either worked the bar nightly or at the very least made a drop in. That particular night he'd called me minutes before my shift. Never a great sign when it happens. Apparently his wife had come down with something bad and he needed to stay home to look after her. He asked if I minded working the bar myself or if I wanted to take the night off. No problem. It's not like bartending was rocket science. I had worked about 4 shifts at this point at the Deep and had a pretty good handle on the job. This wasn't New York City. No one was asking for anything too fancy or complicated. I knew how to pour a beer and make a Jack and Coke. I had memorized the opening and closing checklists. And I could handle myself. Remember, this was Mora, a sleepy town with a population of 1,000. My prediction held up. The night proceeded uneventfully with a slow trickle of customers. Mostly a handful of bearded white guys who I could tell were the regulars. Time crept along slowly that night. By the time that clock read 10 to midnight, the place was almost empty. A middle-aged couple and 3 local mile workers in car hats were there. There was also a man, probably in his 50s with jet black hair. He was alone who'd been drinking steadily the entire evening, sitting at the opposite end of the bar. I wanted to close up early, so I announced last call and of course at that point the guy decided it was an appropriate time to strike up a conversation. So we chatted a bit while I wiped down the bar. Since when does Darren have new worker behind the bar? Ain't never seen you here before, the loner stated, clearly tipsy. I just moved here a few weeks ago, I explained. He lifted his beer up to cheers and smirked playfully. Sorry to hear that. The guy seemed friendly enough. He worked a few towns away as a janitor and bus driver for high school. I told him I had interviewed at the school for teaching job that every morning. He asked how it went and I said I thought I'd failed it, which was true. Sometimes you just have a great feeling in the room and you know it's a surefire thing. Still though, not wanting to jinx it, I rubbed my knuckles against the dark oak bar top 3 times in quick succession. Knock on wood, I said, as one does. The man stiffened, face noticeably draining of blood. I detected a distinct change in his demeanor. You shouldn't do that, he said in a low voice. My forehead scrunched in confusion. Do what? I had no clue what he was referring to. You mean this? I went to knock on the bar again. His hand reached out, grabbed my wrist and stopped me. He held my fist about the bar for a time, trembling. Don't, he begged. He carefully released my hand. I stepped back, not comfortable with this interaction. I looked around the bar and saw the couple and the 3 men watching up closely. Don't knock on wood again, he commanded ominously, sitting back. Why not? I said. It's just a silly thing people do for good luck. Only bad things come of it here. My friend John, we were out one night. He was telling me about this girl he was seeing. He didn't want it to go south, so he knocked on wood like you did. Later it started. What started? Terrible things. Terrible things started happening to him. One damn thing after another. Lost his job, girlfriend left him. Everything in his life went from bad to worse. His luck ran out. Then he started calling me in the middle of the night, saying something was coming for him, saying he kept seeing it, hearing it. The man took a breath, fear was in his voice. Couple nights later, I went to his home to check on him. Hadn't heard from him for a few days. When I walked in, all I saw no trace of him. Never saw him again. Cops haven't a clue. I swallowed. Maybe it's just an awful coincidence. It's not just him. I know plenty of others who have done it. All knocked and been through hell. Every time you knock, you risk calling it. Inviting it into your life. Inviting who? The evil. It was at that moment the middle-aged woman piped up. Don't listen to Gary, girl. He's just being an ass. The man who was apparently Gary shot her a fiery look. Calm down, I interjected. One of the three men drinking at the table, a young guy with a shoddy goatee, stood up. Damn it, the man is speaking the truth. My cousin Duane disappeared too. They never caught the guy. My uncle said that a week before it happened, the two of them were talking. He trailed off as his two drinkmates ushered him to a chair, tugging his sleeve. Shoddy continued. My cousin had just found out he was gonna be a father and was saying how he was hoping his wife would have a boy. He really wanted a son. He knocked and disappeared a few days later under strange circumstances. She lost the... That's enough, one of his friends demanded, putting him back to his seat. To my right, I could hear the squeak of a stool shifting. I looked over to see the middle-aged woman's husband throw down some cash on the counter. He'd had enough of this. Gary leaned across the bar and looked at me extremely serious. I know it sounds insane. It's something we all do out of habit, you know? It seems harmless. But are you willing to take that risk? I shook my head, not sure what to believe. We shouldn't talk about it anymore. Talking about it will only make it worse. Just don't do it again. I was silent. I didn't really know what else to say. Gary flumped out his wallet, no longer wanting to be in this bar for another second. He paid and lurched out, then stepping by the door, turned to Ed. Be careful. Then he was gone. The energy in the room now sapped. It only took a few minutes for the rest of the people to clear out. Before I knew it, I was alone. Don't knock on wood? Seriously? Where did Gary stand on throwing salt over one's shoulder? Could I hang a horseshoe above my front door? I laughed to myself at the absurdity of it all. This guy was a piece of work. But Gary had succeeded at one thing, creeping me the hell out. Tonight I just wanted to do the bare minimum and go home. And as I was wiping the bar, grazing my hand mindlessly across the surface, thalik, I suddenly recoiled my hand in pain. I held it up into the light to see what had happened. There, in the mid between my thumb and index finger, was a nasty wooden splinter. It was embedded deep within the skin. I spent a few minutes in the bathroom, digging and poking at it under running water, trying to no avail to squeeze it out. This sucker was really jammed in here. My father had always told me that skin would naturally find a way to reject splinters or anything small that didn't belong. But I had no idea how my body would work for this one out. Finally, I gave up, resigned to my fate of a sore hand for the next few days. Just my luck. The faint sound of three quick little knocks stirred me. I looked up confused. What was that? It had come from the main room of the bar. I left the bathroom and stepped out into the long hall that led to the bar. From my perspective, though, I couldn't see the entire room. There was a blind spot at the mouth of the hole. I slowly crept forward, craning my neck as best I could as I approached this compromised corner. Hello? My mind worked through all the logical explanations of what the sound could have been. The mop might have fallen over and knocked against something. Maybe Darren had decided to stop by after all, but there was no reply. Knock, knock, knock. I slowed. Now I knew I wasn't imagining things. I definitely heard something. My eyes refused to blink, anxious about what might be waiting in the next room. The sound had been one of a light tapping on the bar top, like someone had knocked on it. Darren, that you? No response. I pushed forward to where the hole opened up into the bar, stood at the edge for a second, cautiously scanning the room. It looked empty. I walked over to peer behind the bar, checking to see if Darren was indeed tinkering around back there. But that and the rest of the room were clear. No falling mop either. What the hell was going on? I knew I had heard. Knock, knock, knock. I stiffened on high alert. At that point, there was no denying it. Something wasn't right. I couldn't tell where the sound was coming from. It might have been outside. Yeah, maybe outside. I felt very uneasy. Who was doing this? Was Gary the janitor still hanging around playing a game of let's freak out the new bartender? I hated games like that. I grabbed a bottle of cheap liquor from the back wall to use for protection. Taking a deep breath, I hid it for the front door. I slowly unlocked the door. This action caused a sharp pain through my head. That splinter still agitating. I grit my teeth and cracked the door open. I raised the bottle high with my other hand, ready to smash someone in the face if need be. But when I stepped outside into the vacant parking lot, there was no one. The only car there was mine. There was an eerie stillness in the air. I walked out a few feet into the night and scanned around. All I could see were the faint gray outlines of the surrounding trees, like tall ominous monoliths. I saw no one lurking the heavy shadows in between. A cold wind blew. The wind rustled through the trees, snapping and rattling all the spindly branches above. Maybe the knocking I'd heard was just the sound of trees blending in the wind. Yup, that could have been it. I went back inside, being sure to lock the door. As I gathered my belongings, something caught my attention, not quite how it was possible. But sure enough, a section of the oak countertop had completely rotted, like it was infested with termites who had run rampant for days. A thought occurred to me. This was the same spot I had knocked on wood earlier. Knock, knock, knock. My breath caught in my throat. There he was. A man standing at the opposite end of the lawn bar by the front door. Everything inside me was steadying to flee, but I couldn't. I couldn't see his face from where I stood. One thing was for sure. This wasn't the janitor. The guy was too tall, too thin. Something was strange with his head. Bar is closed, I sneaked out. The man said nothing. He just stood there watching me, silent. What do you want? I shuddered. His mouth opened as if to speak. No sound came forth. He took his fist suddenly and knocked it against his chest. Knock, knock, knock. It sounded exactly like the knocking before, but now much, much louder. I took another guarded step backwards, and with that he lunged at me. I grabbed the closest bottle and I ran for the back exit. The sound of knocking chased after me, bouncing off the walls, raging in my ears. With no other choice, I ducked into the bathroom. Go away, I screamed, backing into the corner of the small windowless room. He beat against the door wildly. It sounded like a dozen fists pounding at once. In a matter of seconds, this man, this creature, would be in the room with me. He wriggled, violently ripping his arm through the hole that he already made. I heard the sound of heavy footsteps as the thing apparently fled. Then nothing. All was quiet. The attack had stopped. I knew I couldn't stay here forever. He'd be back, and when he returned, he'd be angrier than ever. I steeled myself and opened the door. The dark hallway appeared empty. There was still no sign of him. It looked clear, so I sprinted for my car. I fished out my keys and slept into the front seat, locking the doors. I needed to focus. I didn't know these forested black roads very well. The few scattered houses I did see were either ominously dark or boarded up. I couldn't afford to get lost in this web. I needed to find anyone. The rain was pouring down so hard. No network. There wouldn't be one until I got closer to town. I tightened my fist back around the wheel and grimaced in pain. My hand hurt more than ever now. This was some awful splinter. To my shock, the skin near the sliver had now turned black. It looked deeply infected, like a sore that had gone weeks without treatment. What was happening to me? Before I could even begin to wrap my head around this gruesome sight, a distinct noise cut through the beating rain. It came from above. A moment later, a lush oak tree fell directly onto the road 10 feet ahead of me. I had no time to react. I was driving too fast. The next moment, I collided with it. And then, just before everything went completely, totally, horrifyingly dark, there, somewhere in the back of my ears, I swear, I heard a noise that will haunt for me for the rest of my life. Knock, knock, knock.